Today, the students are going to pretend that they're animals. Some students may be carnivores, omnivores, or herbivores, but based off the food that they collect, they're going to see whether they can survive in their environment or not. I hope that the students will learn that different animals depend on certain environments for survival needs. And sometimes animals migrate, or sometimes animals may pass away and die off for other animals' survival needs. I enjoy teaching science because it really sparks children's interest. And it makes them wonder about things that either they've wondered about on their own and never really had it addressed, and it kind of answers their curiosities about things.
I'd like to welcome Morgan Seidner from the Hickman Mills School District. And today, Morgan's gonna talk with us about a lesson that she did with her fourth graders on how organisms meet their needs in their own environment. So Morgan, would you like to tell us just a little bit about the lesson?
First, I engaged them by asking them what they ate for breakfast. And so when we made a list of everything that they ate for breakfast, we had them kind of figure out what type of consumer or what type of producer that their breakfast came from. So they were really excited about that, because students love to tell you what they like to eat.
What on this list does not make him a carnivore? Donna, what are you thinking? The hash browns, and what else? There's another thing. Carlo, what else? And the orange juice, because the orange juice comes from a... comes from a plant.
So you did that engagement piece, and they were excited about telling you what they had for breakfast. And then did you do explore next?
What we did was we went out to the front of our school, and I had already laid out different color of Fruit Loops so that the students can go out and pretend that they were organisms in the environment. So they had 3 minutes. And of course, I had explained to them not to push or shove or whatever. But
they were fighting for food.
Yeah, they were fighting. But it was really cool.
Right. So they went out and they collected. And did they just put those in baggies, or how did they collect?
They put them in brown sandwich bags.
Okay.
I didn't use clear because I didn't want them to kind of look and see what they had.
And then you came back inside. Now was this? Did you explain then, or did you still? Were you still going through the explore phase?
We were still going through the explore phase. After that, I incorporated math by having my students do a three-dimensional bar graph. And that's why we have these sticks here.
Okay, so tell me a little bit about these, because these look really interesting.
Yeah, what they did was they had to put each color of Fruit Loop on each different stick. A lot of the Fruit Loops stood for water, some stood for meat, and the others stood for plants.
David's already kind of thinking he's not gonna survive. He said, oh, my friend Demarion took all my ribs.
And Demarion followed me everywhere I went.
So what does that mean with animals? So if you have an animal that's following another animal around, do you think they'll have enough chance to get the same amount of food?
No.
That happens in nature.
And then you handed them a card.
Yes.
Correct? So each student, and randomly? Did you just do that randomly?
I randomly just handed out cards.
Okay.
And the card showed what type of consumer that they were.
So somebody might have gotten a card that said omnivore, someone herbivore, carnivore, whatever. It just depended.
Yes.
I'm a carnivore.
So here's an example for omnivore. You're an omnivore. You can eat meat and plants. You also need water. The purple and blue loops represent water. You can count the red, orange, green, and yellow loops for food. You need 20 loops of them to survive, plus at least 5 blue and purple loops. So the kids had to go back and recount, and then that's how they figured out if they survived or not.
All right, so some students survived and some did not.
Yeah, some did not.
I bet they were devastated,
weren't
they?
They were like, oh!
Oh,
so
that's
it was
cute.
Cool.
That's neat. So then they did that, and then what was the next piece? What did you do to evaluate the lesson?
Towards the end, they had these journals. And towards the end of it, they had questions that they answered.
Okay.
Well, I also had them graph.
Oh, so whatever they did on the three-dimensional graph, they also did, and this stood for the colors, red, orange, yellow. Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
And then on the back, there's conclusions. So that's how I kind of evaluated to see if the students knew kind of the purpose of it, the objective.
Okay, and then any other piece of the lesson that we didn't talk about?
Well, towards the end, it's kind of the elaboration, kind of evaluation piece, and then just something for them to think about. I asked them what type of consumer had a better chance to survive in our fixed environment that we made. Mm-hmm. So a lot of students said it was based off
it was based off what each person collected.
Is it important that all animals survive in an environment?
No.
Not even.
It's like, if an animal can't eat the other animal, if it has to eat the other animal so it can survive. And like, we have to eat that animal that eats the other animal, because if they don't, if all the animals survive, we ain't gonna have nothing to eat.
Well said.
So just tell us a little bit about what you had to do to get ready for the lesson. What, because this is wet clay?
Yes.
And what are these, coffee stirrers?
Yes, so I had Fruit Loops. I already had the molding clay inside of my classroom, mm-hmm. Play-Doh or whatever. The only thing I really had to purchase was the coffee stirrers.
Coffee stirrers.
Printing out the cards to let the kids know what type of consumer they were. And really just cutting them out and passing them out. So it really wasn't that much preparation.
Okay, well, that doesn't sound too bad. Okay, one thing I wanted to talk with you about, I noticed on the back of your journal, you had them write a line of learning. So could you let us know a little bit about this? What does line of learning stand for?
The line of learning I do at the close of each science lesson. And that just basically summarizes what the kids took from the lesson.
Okay, so do you mostly do this on every science lesson? Do you
mostly
have them do this?
Yes.
That's perfect. Though these turned out really good. I like the fact that you can do these and then put them into your other science journals as well. Okay. Well, I'd like to take a look at what your kids had to say about the lesson.
Okay.
Let's do that.
Okay.
I learned how animals survive and how much food they need to eat to survive.
What I liked most was when I figured out which kind of consumer I was.
Well, I learned that an omnivore is an animal that eats plants, meat, and drinks water.
Science can teach us so many things that we don't know. If we didn't know about ecosystems or carnivores and omnivores and herbivores, then we won't know like what animals really eat. Then we won't get out our own ideas and tell other kids the things they don't know.
My name is Amari, and science matters to me.
My name is Michael, and science matters to me.
My name is Xavier, and science matters to me.
I'm David, and science matters to me.
I'd like to thank Morgan for joining us today in the Science Matters Studio Lab. You can download this complete lesson and learn more tips and strategies for teaching science in your class at sciencemattersonline.com. Thanks to our sponsors and all the teachers from the Blue Springs Center, Hickman Mills, and Wellington Napoleon School Districts.